Hello everyone, my name is Steven Zapata. I'm a concept artist, illustrator, online art teacher, and former instructor at Art Center College of Design. I would like to introduce you to my new drawing course, Form from Imagination, a course designed to help you draw with confidence from your mind. Maybe you want to be a professional illustrator or designer, maybe you want to be a master with a pencil, or maybe you just want to be the best artist that you can be. Beautiful goals, but it's not always clear how to improve the work that you do from imagination. Over the past 6 months, I've taken all of the little eurekas, tips, and essential exercises that gave me confidence drawing from my mind and compiled them into a sequential course. We start with the absolute foundations, covering the scientific nature of light and shadow, how to hatch, how to create flat tones, how to render spheres and cubes. And step by step, we move through combined shapes, complex shapes, organic shapes. We cover how to simplify extremely complex subjects like the head into basic shapes so that you can handle them more easily from your head. We look at how to understand and treat details. And by the end of these 14 chapters with over 50 video lessons, you'll be ready to do complex designs from your mind with fidelity and energy. And all the demos are done in pencil on paper, so you can do all of the assignments even if you don't have a fancy digital art setup. But I also have demos, instructions, and modifications to the assignments for those who do want to do them digitally. Here's how it works. Go to formfromimagination.com and sign up for the course. Download the assignment book and start watching the lectures. Do the assignments at your own pace. Take your time with them and use this self-study to develop your patience. When you're done, post your assignments in the exclusive community hub, and I'll personally critique your work with drawovers, diagrams, and advice. I want you to know, this course is no joke just because it's online. It is challenging content. And it is more complete than it would be if I was teaching this class at an art college as I have before. If I was teaching this class in person at Art Center today, I would just play these videos in class, knowing full well that they're the most concise, focused, edited, step-by-step way to convey the material. So I'm serious when I say this course isn't just a substitute for a college-level course, it's better than a college-level course. And you don't have to pay thousands of dollars per credit and wind up hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt. So thank you for checking out the course. Thank you for watching this and for your support. And thank you for drawing and making your artwork. The world needs it. I'll see you soon.
Come in. Oh,
hello. Joseph, is it?
Hi, Dr. Zapata. Yes, Joseph. Joe, how are you?
I'm well. What seems to be the problem, Joe?
Well, I'm having difficulty drawing from imagination.
Oh. Joseph, just so you know, that's totally normal. Why don't you tell me a little more about your problem? Is it that you can only draw from imagination if you're completely alone?
Doc, I can't ever draw from imagination.
What about if you're completely relaxed?
When I'm totally relaxed, I can't imagine a thing.
I see. Joseph, it's important to know that even with severe cases like this, there's always hope. I can prescribe an experimental therapy called Form from Imagination.
Form from Imagination?
Mm-hmm. It's early days, but clinical trials are extremely promising. Why don't you try this for 6 months and then check back in with me?
Hmm? Okay, I'll do whatever it takes. Did you just draw this?
Oh, yeah.
Wow, that's amazing. Doc, do you ever have trouble drawing from imagination?
Oh, no. No.
You wouldn't. I mean, you drew this.
That's right.
Wow.
Form from Imagination is an experimental therapy and is not yet approved for use by the FDA. Do not use Form from Imagination if you are already taking any prescriptions for drawing from reference, working site size, or tracing photos you didn't even take. Stop taking Form from Imagination if you experience any of these side effects: loss of interest in your personal projects, megalomaniacal self-confidence, hallucinations, unless they're the kind you're hoping for, drawing better than Steven Zapata, or feelings that purchasing the course was enough and you don't really need to do the exercises. Call your doctor if you have stiff gestures, flat forms, or boring ideas to address a possible life-threatening condition. Full sketchbooks have been reported with form from imagination and medicines like it. Other risks include long-term art careers, too many clients, and being worth more than you're charging for. Call your doctor today and ask about form from imagination.
Stream activate. Stream activate. Testing audio. What's all this? Sorry, gotta move that there. That's over there. Is my mic in the shot? No. I want to put this down. You know, when I'm working digital, I gotta have just the exact right amount of swivel on my chair, or else I'm not a happy boy. Video feed up there. I can see chat. Hair in my damn eyes. Hello to JLN Rowe. Rodrigo Nicolas, Neil Kowalkowski, Oster, Gabuda, Ichamuda, Quanto, Ricky White, my dear, Joseph Marzeliano, a rare Phil Worth in the chat, who says, hi, finally catching the stream. Welcome, Phil. Good to see you. Charlie and Air Temptress. Hello, everybody. Jenny Craddock, Snooge, hello, hello. JLN Rowe says, you look like a lion from Lion King, Steven. You want to hear my lion roar? Here it goes. It's my fearsome lion's roar. My allergies are very bad today, so I apologize. You will probably hear me clearing my throat a lot on this stream. If it goes another way, I would be very happy of that. I'm sick of clearing my throat. But I just want to apologize if that gets quite prevalent and annoying. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? We're going to poke at this guy for a while. And then we may do more like him. I may further develop this one, or take the idea and do a new comp. I don't remember what that one was starting as, but to get it going, let's poke at this one a little bit. And I already see something I want to fix. Nice way to start. I don't like that these two mushrooms are basically the exact same size and stacked right on top of each other, a repetition that I don't want. So, I'm gonna stop being lazy and I'm gonna cut out this foreground mushroom and then I'm gonna move that top one. Nice straightforward way to start the day. Wait a second, I have to start my stopwatch. You know how important my stopwatch is to me. Gabuda Ichamuda says, loving form from imagination so far. Nice, yes, beautiful. It's helping me actually think about my art rather than it being wild and overly fueled by negative emotion. I love it. I love it so much. That's great to hear. I'm very happy that it's helping Ichamuda. tired Ennio says, why are you so scary? I don't know. I mean, my fearsomeness is created in your mind. So I guess the better question is, why are you making me so scary? What about me do you find so troubling? You're in good company, though. There's a lot of people online. A lot of people online who find Stevie Boy very scary. A lot of vociferous detractors of SB. We'll do a copy merged and then paste that, and then that'll be the exact same value, correct. Clip that, yep. Now let's paint out what's behind here a little bit. Is it a count down or count up stopwatch? Count up. Hello, Sploige. CLC3897 says, recent subscriber here. Glad to be here. Happy to have you. Very glad to have you here. Thank you for subscribing. Your subscription is appreciated. Two minutes into the stream and you've already taught me another new word? Dude, that's why you gotta catch every stream. Streams are basically a word a day calendar. You can't miss a stream. You'll miss a new word. And what would you do if you missed one of my precious words? Sploige says, is there a set of tips for how to always have fun while drawing, even when doing technical exercises? Well, you don't want to force it. You know, if you find yourself focusing too much on, oh, I need a set of tips, you know, what are the steps, what are the processes? That could be getting in the way too, you know? It's not something you add, it's something you reduce down to, that fun. Again, sorry for my throat, everybody. Do not force it. Go easier on yourself instead of harder. Ease back the throttle on some of those expectations. Easy now, easy now. You know, something that you could try that a lot of people kind of resist. If you don't do anything like this in your life, I think this is probably a good place to start for the having fun while drawing. When you sit down to work, just take 1 minute, just 60 seconds to begin with. You know, you could do more later, but if you've never done stuff like this before, just take 1 minute before you touch paper, before you touch the pencil to the paper, before you open Photoshop, just sit and close your eyes and just remind yourself why you were doing this. And build determination, consciously build determination to work in alignment with your values. I can't give like a lot of specifics there because everybody has different values around why they work, but just take a minute to consciously say them to yourself and see if that doesn't make it a little easier to enjoy your sessions regularly. Align, align, align. Charlie says, Steven, I got feedback for my stuff, and some say that I need to work on my style, but I'm not quite sure what's the true definition of style. More aesthetic, shape, line, or philosophical what? I find it very not useful to discuss style. I think working on your style, quote unquote, almost always reduces to working on something else, like a particular understanding of a fundamental, like values or color or something like that. Or it reduces down to that other thing that you alluded to, which is a philosophical outlook. And that can mean a life philosophy, right, which can affect the way you work, but it can also mean a philosophy about a principle of art or a principle of design, right? You can have a philosophy about why you use what kinds of lines or you don't, or why you create your values the way that you do or don't, right? I think over the years, those kinds of decisions aggregate into what other people see as a style, but I don't think style can sort of be pursued on its own, at least not in a robust way. Like, you can force a style that doesn't feel natural, right? Sometimes you have to do that for work because you're supposed to match the look of something else on the project, but that's not really sustainable in the long run. You know, the constant policing, sort of undoing your natural inclinations to make them fit something else that you need to hit, you eventually get tired of that and burnt out on that. So I think that what everyone's looking for is a more natural fit. But yeah, it's not something to be pursued for its own sake. You always arrive at it by accident while handling other things. Let me reposition my camera here. Okay, I'm roughly in the center there. Let me move this mic. Hey, Mel. How you doing, Ming? Hello, Jevica. Hello, Tet. Ayub says, do you know about Monster Garden channel? Yeah, I saw that video of Monster Gardens that popped off. That one that went viral. It had like a couple million views. It was like designing, what was it, a gnome or something like that? Or like a redesign of dwarves or something like that? I saw that one. being merged here. Question is, do I want this one bigger or smaller? Let's do smaller. Paint this out. I'm just going to put that guy there and I'll add some more. I feel like I like him sitting on the edge there. Autumn Rose says, Stephen, I was wondering if you have any tips for artists who spend too much time on social media and not enough time making and consuming art. Just cut it off. I mean, it doesn't need to be forever, but I think it's good for artists to be used to sort of experimenting with their lives, you know. Most of the artists who made really incredible work and had long careers were deeply weird people. I don't know how else to put it. They just had strange, unusual lives, were strange people. And they just didn't have, you know, this kind of comes off as very pretentious and bohemian, but yeah, it's art, so what else is going to be pretentious and bohemian? But it's just like, they didn't really have the lives that non-artists have. So if you're going to do that too, I'm not saying you need to be, you know, Andy Warhol or anything like that, but you should probably expect that some of that is just part of the practice. So just delete your social media, you know, not close your account, but just take it off your phone for a while and play with it. It doesn't need to be forever. Just try it for a week, you know, and build the muscle that's able to like detox from that stuff. Right now, for the past like maybe 2 weeks or something like that. I'm like very, very minimal right now on anything. I'm off podcasts, audiobooks, music, everything. I'm not listening to anything, no YouTube videos. Once my wife leaves the house to go to work, I'm just in silence. You know, I'm in silence right now on stream, but I'm talking. But if I wasn't streaming, I'd just be working here in quiet. I turned off my YouTube watch history, so YouTube doesn't show me anything. When I open YouTube, it's blank. It just says your watch history is off. It doesn't even show me Mr. Beast's stupid face. I'm not, he's probably a nice guy, but there's probably a lot of Mr. Beast fans out there, but it's just like overexposure, you know? No Instagram on my phone, no social media on my phone right now. I just leave my phone in the bathroom all day. Very, very minimal right now. Very, very minimal. Mind you, I'm not saying it's fun. There's been days where it's really not a struggle at all. Like yesterday wasn't a struggle at all. It was just completely without any inputs, and I barely even noticed it. And there's other days where the boredom is like overwhelming. I'm not committed to, you know, I don't have something in my head like, this is me from now on. It's like, I'm just playing, just experimenting. Steven, you still read books though, right? Yes. I still do my morning reading. It's been good. In the past 2 weeks of being very minimal, I caught up on I had 3 books on my book backlog, and I finished 2 of them, Killers of the Flower Moon and The Wager. They were good. I like them. And I have 1 more book on my backlog, Sutri by Cormac McCarthy. I was reading that this morning. I need to create some more little frames. I destroyed some of my frames as I was painting around. I heard the Flower Moon film is pretty good. I haven't seen it. I've read the book now, but I haven't seen the movie yet. Neil says, only ever read The Road from Cormac McCarthy. Best description of a real apocalypse ever, but also depressing. Yeah, pretty depressing. It's been a long time since I read The Road. I read that, must have been 2009, probably. Because I remember reading it in California. But I wasn't in school, so it must have been between 2008 and 2009. The Road's great. No Country for Old Men is a classic. It's interesting, though. I mean, there's definitely a difference between old Cormac and newer Cormac. I mean, The Road and No Country for Old Men are definitely his, definitely feel like new Cormac, you know, more bare, more stripped down. The Passenger feels like a bit of a return to, in areas, it feels like a return to old Cormac. I really love The Passenger. I think The Passenger might be my favorite book of all time. But, you know, something like Blood Meridian, which is great, is, it's very dark as well. Like, Blood Meridian is very dark, like The Road, but unlike The Road, there's, like, at least for me, there's, like, laugh out loud, like, comedy in Blood Meridian. And it's definitely more embroidered than The Road, at least from what I remember of The Road. Like I said, I read it a very long time ago. Not a lot of jokes in The Road, from what I remember. Tata says, I loved your art talk about the esoteric aspects of meditation. Oh, thank you. I've personally experienced lots of esoteric things myself. Nice to hear your perspective on it. Perhaps another episode in the future. I would not count it out. I mean, you know, those are some of the most important things in my life, and they overlap with everything else. So I think inevitably it will all be brought up again and again. And again, but I'm glad you liked it. Curse Vita says, if you were a skeleton warrior, what would be your fighting style? My fighting style would be like having 50 arms, like the arms that I stole from other skeleton warriors, and each arm holds a little dagger, and I just sort of walk towards my enemy like this, with all the daggers stabbing one after the other. I think that would be my style. Tired Ennio says, any advice on doing big digital paintings with many different colors and making colors feel coherent? Color is a very complex topic. It'd be hard to give any like quick tips that would apply to everything. I mean, there's some basic overall principles that you should always keep in mind, like, you know, you want to generally you just want to have, you want to pick your colors with intent. That often looks like creating a palette with intention, right? Like, just if you've never done this before, I know this is very basic, but it's like, you can see if colors look good together by just doing this. Just little swatches. Like, I don't think those look particularly good, but that's a palette, right? So you can just look at that and assess, like, do those actually jive, you know? And there's no rules to that, right? It's color theory. It is color theory. People will tell you, you know, compliments always look good together. It's like, oh, yeah, well, yeah, they have a bit of contrast to them, but that doesn't mean that they're always the right answer for a particular kind of painting, right? So you just pick things with intent. So you can do a little swatch palette just to guide your intention. Just to say, those six look good together. And then you can anchor a whole painting off of that. Besides that, you know, color circulation is usually a good idea. You know, the things that are on your palette, like, unless you want, like, let's say these purples here, unless these purples are reserved for the absolute most important point of emphasis in the painting, you probably want to sneak them in throughout the picture. You know, you just want to circulate the color, having little daubs of all of the medium importance colors all around the picture helps to add cohesion and things like that. Mr. Kizzle says, my wife thinks you are handsome. She has excellent taste. Rob says, No Country is also excellent. It is. That was the first Cormac McCarthy book that I ever read. My, an English teacher that I really liked in high school had us read it as a school assignment. He forced us to read it, and that was very kind of him. That was definitely one of those books where I was like, oh, this is awesome. This is worth investing my own time to read things like this. I can't remember his name right now. I'm brain farting. Why can't I remember his name? It's an Italian name. It's slipping my mind. Hey, Arctic Monkey. Lassie talks about art, says the beard has not been shaved, which is good, low-key. I'm just lazy to shave it. I gotta get around to it. All right, well, that's better. Better for me than what I had. I'll just angle this slightly different. so that it has an opposing curve to the one above. Help differentiate them even more. Ooh, these damn allergies. All right, that's fine for now. That's fine for now. Nothing to worry about. Well, that's fine for now. Let's goose some of this stuff in the foreground. I've got to goose it. Seconding Tuta's recommendation of looking into James Gurney's stuff for learning about color. Yeah, Gurney's Color and Light book is awesome. A really great introduction to how light makes the world look the way it looks, which is a really important thing for artists to come to grips with. Great introduction to that. Prith13 says, I like many different art styles and want to do them. I like anime, I like realism, I like semi-realism, abstract, etc., etc. Is it okay? Am I going to need to pick one and give all of myself to it? There are no rules in art. You never have to ask, is it okay? It's okay. It's okay. You don't have to pick. You can do everything that you want to do. If you want to get into an industry, there's a particular, if you want to do art as a job or something like that, there, that doesn't mean you have to stop doing all the other things you want to do, but yeah, usually to get traction in an industry, you need to focus in on one thing in order to be able to sort of hit the sort of attention-grabbing professional level there. There's no real way around that. But even while you do that, there's nothing stopping you from doing all the other things you love. And if that is not your goal, then you really, you should just follow your heart. Follow your heart day to day. There's nothing wrong with being broad-based. Do you have a Zapataverse or world-building project you're working on ever, or anything akin to that? I'm doing that right now. This is for a project with my buddy Joe. We've been working on it. I mean, I'm doing VizDev right now, like doing all the pre-production and design stuff. That's what all this business is, and I have much, much more of this. We've been working on it as a graphic novel. Ahmed, how are you, sir? Good to see you, buddy. Let me see some of these questions that I missed up here before I get to Med. I know everyone knows who you are and what you do and all your biographical data. Literally just found you a couple days ago and watched several of your videos, but I don't know anything else. Would you be willing to share a bit about yourself? I'm totally blanking on who the hell I am. I'm from New York City. I've been drawing my whole life. I really started trying to improve when I was around 14 years old. I moved to California to go to college for art at Art Center College of Design in Los Angeles. I stayed out in LA for about 10 years. That was going to school and then working in studio. I've worked in theme parks, print, video games, advertising, illustration, all sorts of stuff. I made this YouTube back in 2019, and I've been doing a lot of YouTube since then, also while doing commercial work and things like that. I teach a lot of students. I've done workshops, given talks all over the place. Past 2 years, or like year and a half, I did a lot of AI advocacy stuff. Yeah, I think that's a good quick summary. Zeddeck said Stegen. I recently got a crit from you on a drawing in the Form for Imagination community page. I think I'll restart the course now and try to perfect everything and push it that extra limit. FFI made me better. Thanks. I'm very glad that Form for Imagination is helping you, but I love the energy, and I'm sure your heart's coming from the right place, but the course is super hard. Nope, nobody has finished it. it's a lot of work, a lot of assignments, and most people get so good in the middle of it that they just have to move on to becoming incredible world-class professionals or doing their personal projects because they're just too excited about the skills that they built. So I'm not sure I recommend starting over. I'm really not. I mean, like, you don't have to get super rigid about, I got to do it perfect, 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 perfect. Consider just keep going. Just keep going exactly where you were and bring that vigor and that energy and the desire to do submit the best single image that you can. Just apply it to the next one. If you feel like you missed particular learning outcomes as they're described in the assignment book from previous assignments, try doing the assignments again tiny in your sketchbook. You don't need to resubmit them. You don't need to do them 6 inches wide so that they're these polished things. But like, if you feel like, oh, there's something I wasn't quite getting about the sphere and I feel like I see it now, render the hell out of a sphere just like 2 inches wide in your sketchbook. Do like a little thumbnail of it. With a simple thing like a sphere on a table, you can actually nail everything at a tiny size fast. And the only part you're not going to rehearse is the craftsmanship aspect of carefully moving all of your gradations over large areas of paper. I just want you to conserve your energy. You know, I'm not sure it's the best idea to just start over because you got a crit and suddenly you have all this energy inside of you. You know, you don't need to overreact, you know. Not saying it's an overreaction. Like I said, I love where you're coming from, but just something to think about. Ahmed's first message was, perhaps we may consider not using Steven's platform as a dating site. I see there's some removed messages. I wonder what, were people trying to hook up with each other? It happens. Mm-hmm. How you doing, Med? You a happy boy? Ooh, Istabrak is here too. Hello, Istabrak. How are you? I don't think I've chatted with you since we did the AI panel on Adam Duff's channel. Good to see you. Ahmed giving wise advice. All right. Everybody V happy then. Everybody very happy. What was I doing? Right, this foreground stuff. Let's just put some indications of what the heck I actually want this all to look like, vines and things like that. Pointier brush, please. Thorns, thorns, thorns. I have not quite decided for myself if the walkway would be more vines or if it's like they're holding up an actual surface. Not sure. Still don't know. Not ready to commit to anything there. Ahmed says, and yeah, life is good, man. Just healing and chilling. Glad to hear it, buddy. Are you still on the road or are you back home? Sorry if you don't feel like revealing that information. I realize we're in public. Just ignore my question. Sabrak says, what do you usually get up to in your streams? Just stuff like this. I don't know. I do all sorts of things. Usually I sketch on stream. I don't usually come in with something I'm in the middle of working on like this. I usually like to stream as sort of just structureless, fun having time. That's what most of my streams are by volume. Let's lay some Maybe there's like some kind of very natural, like wooded surface suspended between these sort of railings of thorns. What was my value structure here? Whoops. Let's actually keep it. Well, let's move some. You know, when you've got like a very compressed shape, it's like this pathway sort of doubles over itself. You know, it bends one way, bends the other, bends again, goes off over there. It's a very compressed shape. It barely takes up anything on the canvas, actually, just in a 2D sense, but it's supposed to imply a lot of depth. It's basically one value right now, this flat gray. You know, it has some stuff scribbled over it, but it doesn't really have a lot of value change. Usually it helps to add significant value change that helps make it feel like it is covering more distance. You know, value change implies form change. So even on flat surfaces, it tends to just, I don't know how to say it, just like the more gradation changes there are, the larger the scale of that surface tends to feel. Half the time when I give tips like that on stream, I then try it and then I'm like, nah, fuck it, it doesn't look good. I don't even wind up doing it. Let's just put the shadow there, and then maybe there's something else. It's just some value breakups like that. You can see if you look small. Helps that flat gray field feel a little more believable that it's actually covering, you know, 100 feet, 200 feet, something like that. Sick Shroomsville, says Ahmed. You know, gotta honor the shrooms. You've got to honor them. Yolo says, whoa, another great day because of a Zapata stream. Egg salad. Egg salad. Egg salad. Istabrak says, I'm in the middle of the workday. Wanted to hop in and say hi. Hope I catch the next one. Bye, guys. Goodbye, Istabrak. Goodbye. Good luck with your workday. Lassie says, when you sketch, not talking about big project pieces for fun, what makes you decide to do it digitally, traditionally? Is it vibes-based or are there more concrete reasons? My preference is traditional. I usually will sketch digital if I'm coming in with a taste to do the things digital is good at, which for me, I should say I'm making this evaluation because for me, when I consider sketching traditional, I always, almost always am thinking of drawing with pencil, right? So pencil is a small point, makes it difficult to make large areas of value, or at least there's more resistance to doing that. So if I want to do a sketch, if I have a taste for doing something that is large shapes, you know, silhouettes, something more akin to painting that is made up of big patches of value, it's much easier to get that going quickly digitally than it is with pencil, especially if you're just exploring. Same for if I'm sitting down to sketch and I know I want to sketch in color, same thing. Then I'm much more inclined to do digital just because it's... Oh, I don't have a layer factory installed. Do I? No, I don't. Sorry, I got distracted. What was I saying? So yeah, if I know I have a taste to work in color, I'll usually start digital. You see, I have this multiply layer here because I'm working on layers that have varying levels of transparency. When I merge this down, the value changes, very annoying. If you have trouble with that in your process often, there's workarounds for it. You know, you can control your clipping layers differently and things like that. But there is a plugin for Photoshop by Sergey Kritsky called Layer Factory that has a button called Bake to Normals that solves that problem. And I just have not, I forget why I took Layer Factory off. When I switched my PC and changed my Photoshop. I just haven't gotten around to reinstalling it just because I haven't done work lately that needs all the things Layer Factory is good at. But if that is a problem you bump into all the time, check out Layer Factory. Makes it easy to handle that. Drawing shrooms is so fun. Will there be shroom people too? There are... Technically, yes. I had to think about it for a second. Let's say yes. It's like, are you even working if you're not doing things on the wrong layer? You're not. You're just messing around. Doing things on the wrong layer is a sign of true focus. Arctic Monkey says, how would you approach those little hilly bumps? I always struggle with making it coherent in the picture as a whole. I don't know what hilly bumps you're talking about. What are you talking about? Hilly bumps in my picture? Or are we talking about hilly bumps in general? I meant hilly bumps in general. The latency seems pretty bad on my end. I don't know. I guess I just don't know what you mean. If you mean like little subforms on like organic things, like on muscles or textures and stuff like that, you just need to make them fit into the contrast hierarchy that you want for the picture. Usually, you want to compress the values on them, make them more subtle than your first instincts are. If you mean hilly bumps like literal hills on a landscape, not sure. I always thought Ines did nice hills. Metcalf. CLC 3897 says, Stephen, I'm a high school teacher, and lately I've been torn between whether I should recommend my students to go to regular university. To study art. What is your take on this? Should they take courses like yours or SVS, for example, or go to college? I struggle with this because I really think it comes down to the individual. You probably can't put it this way. You probably can't put it this way to your students because you're in, you know, a school setting. But I can sort of say it without any tact to summarize it. But my current feeling about it is that if money is no issue for the student, they come from a privileged background, something like that, it's probably a good idea to go to an art school. And they'll meet a lot of other people for whom money is no issue. If you pull back on feeling like that's gross or not a good thing to say, or, you know, just unaccepting of the idea that people have different levels of funds and things like that, it's just the truth. And the case is that the networking is extremely beneficial, and it is important to make friends and be involved in a community and in things like that. Also, being too well off, especially early on, tends to make it a little hard for people to motivate. So the extra push of school can help with that. If money is a problem at all for the student, I don't think it's worth the risk to go to art school. I think it's, at this point, most private art schools are just too fabulously and fantastically expensive. I mean, they're pricing themselves absurdly for what they can actually deliver. There's a few that are actually good. You know, there's a handful of genuinely good schools, but most are just not. And I think that for people who have any financial problem, you just don't go, but you need to then take extremely seriously that you need to network on your own. You need to find your own ways to make friends, go to conventions, start your own groups, make friends online. if you just hole up in your bedroom and get great at art and refuse to make friends, it's not going to go well for 99.9% of people. It's not going to pan out. You can't be totally isolated. It's not going to work. Please try Krita. It's a strong Photoshop rival. I have it installed on this computer. I've tried it. It's hard for me to give anything a real try because I'm just so used to Photoshop. There's programs like Clip Studio that I have felt what's great about them, you know? And I've used Clip a good amount, a considerable amount. It's just what I've been using Photoshop since I was like 12. So it's like very deeply ingrained in me. And anybody who's been on the stream a long time knows that I hate Photoshop. It drives me crazy, but it's just like, it's the abusive partner I keep coming back to just because it's what's comfortable. No privileged kids around here, says CLC3897. I have no issue telling them to take online courses and save money even if they were rich. Yeah, I think the money is really, because it's like, it's different if, you know, you want to be like an investment banker or something like that, where the degree truly credentials you, right? Like, no financial institution is going to want to hire someone who just claims they know how to do that stuff, right? Like the degree really does credential you, like you know how financial products work and the laws around them and things like that. Or at least you've actually been exposed to the knowledge. At least you kind of know what your unknowns are. That just isn't the case with art. Your degree does not credential you. Your degree is very, you know, art is just very, the proof is in the pudding, you know, just or do the pictures look great or not. So, yeah, I'd be saying something different for another field, but for art, you know, the degree doesn't really add up to much. And if you leave school with $100,000 in debt, that can basically be crushing enough, not just financially, but anxiety-wise, that you will be unable to make good art for maybe a decade. I know that's scary to hear, but I think it's just the way of it. I mean, making art requires either, some people go really far just working off of nervous breakdowns, basically. They just produce a huge amount of art sliding from one nervous breakdown to the other. But no one should do that if they can avoid it at all because, well, the consequences are written all over every art history book that you might be interested to pursue. So if you're not doing that, making art requires peace and the ability to sink into work for a very long time and feeling like you cannot make ends meet and you are under a crushing debt burden is basically perfectly orthogonal to those two things. So it can really mess up the practice for like a decade while you get out from under the debt. And some people can handle that, you know, it doesn't mean that once you're out from under the debt, you can piece your shit back together. But if it can be avoided, it's probably a good thing, you know? It's better to be, as an artist, it's better to be a little poorer and not have debt and just be able to find more time to just and just sit and work. Even though we're in a magical mushroom land walking on a thorn pathway, there's going to be crown to the street. Well, the water's got to drain off somewhere. Heverinth says hello. Hello. I just bought Ian McCaig's new sketchbook and it's so inspiring. I wanted a book of just his drawings since forever and I finally have it now. I think I know the one you're talking about. It's got like a tree on the cover, right? Or is that a story that he wrote? I gotta get it. I have got to pick that up. Maybe he's put out a sketchbook and that storybook recently. Avelino says, I love watching your streams. Thank you. Thank you so much. Neil Kowalkowski has mailed mayonnaise to everybody in chat. Excellent. Excellent. Drawing Dama Isaac says, hey, Steven, college is expensive AF, even with grants and scholarships, but classes and the college experience have been very helpful and life-changing, but it is such hard work. You know, if I didn't give that its due thrift, I know. I mean, I went to college. You know, I went to an art college, and I don't regret my experience, but I'm very slow to you know, I have a survivor's bias there, right? Like, it was a very good experience for me, you know, like I made good friends and I went to a very good school and I got a great job right out of school I got a job where I was making a lot of money and I've lived below my means always usually. So I just like pooled all of that money and I just used it to pay off my debt relatively quickly. I mean, I got out of my debt, you know, because I took a lot of loans for school because I don't have independent funds. I don't come from a background where I could pay for school. If I was going to do it, my only option was private loans. So I had some scholarship and I had some grants, but the vast majority of it was private loans. And managed to get those paid off relatively quickly, faster than most people. I mean, I forget. I think it took me like 4 or 5 years, but it's just like, that is just not most people's situation. So if that part had gone differently for me, I would probably still be sitting here suffering the consequences of going to school. So I liked school a lot and I made dear friends like Ahmed in school. It meant a lot to me, but I have to acknowledge that I have a lot of survivor's bias there for that, you know, and it went well for me and that's just not how it's going to go for everybody. Ila says, hey, lots of emphasis on college. I'm wondering, what do you think college gives you and how might one replicate that outside of college, say without ever going or after having going? Someone later in the chat said, at YOLO, the Draftsman podcast has a series of videos about the pros and cons of college and how to replicate the pros without the cons. I feel like I've watched that video. I don't remember the specifics, but I bet Marshall had a lot of good advice there. So yeah, I'd recommend go giving that a listen. That's probably more cumulative than anything I can say here. As I alluded to before, it just comes down to community. So you just need to really aggressively find a community or create a community. I think that's always going to be the main thing. It's very, very difficult to spend all of your art time on your own, just with no guidance, no structure, no one to push against, you know, no like rivals, no friends helping you along. Like all of that stuff is very, it just provides energy, you know, gets you excited, gives you, like I said, just something to push against. No enemies, yeah. I mean, come on, you need some enemies. You know, art is just a very, in the long term, like as you're going through finding out what you want to do and refining your focus and, you know, trying to make your pictures and building up your skills. Art is a very, like, low energy pursuit. I mean, like, physically. Like, you know, you just spend a lot of time alone in a room, not moving much. And for a lot of those years that people are going to attempt those things, those are years where you're gonna, those developmental years are years where you have a lot of need for, like, energetic output and I don't know how else to put it, but just, like, drama, like, yeah, art's one thing, but your mind is also trying to just like get its teeth into the interest that is available in existence. And without some community to settle into, it's just very easy to bounce off of art because it does not give you the variety of experience that you would get if you were in school for something else or working a different kind of job. Just a job, right? Or even on a sports team or something like that. Just like all of those things are just much more viscerally interesting and exciting a lot of the time than making art is until you sort of create your beautiful little inner cathedral that makes art sort of reach the level. Neil says, jokes on you, Zapata. I have many enemies. Get more. Keep them close. Oops. Sorry again about my throat. Go to art schools in New York or New Jersey. I have stopped talking really about what schools I think are good because I've been out of the system long enough that I really have to acknowledge that I would just be talking out of my ass. I mean, I went to Art Center College of Design, which was a good school. I think it still is a good school. But when I went back to teach there just a few years later, I even in just that time, I saw how much the program had changed, you know? So I expect it has only continued to change. And I expect that all of the other schools that I knew were good at the time have had all their programs change. So I'm not going to pretend to be, I'm just not the appropriate person to be talking about that. This would be an easy time for me to speak out of my ass. So I would advise you go look for people who have been in those schools, in those communities more recently and can speak more directly to the nature of the programs currently. Arrowed says, currently taking the Form from Imagination course and I love it. Thank you. I'm always looking for self-paced courses like this. Oh, I'm very glad to provide. I'm very glad to provide one. Thank you so much for getting it. And I'm glad you're loving it. Everything's really coming up peachy for us, isn't it? I'm so glad it's helping. I really like seeing people improve from the course. Seeing the stuff in the feedback area. And seeing like the stuff people post online and things like that. It's very, just extremely heartening to see it helping people, see things clicking. You know, the course was trying to do a lot of crazy stuff. So like every time in the, like in the feedback section, when I'm going in to do feedback for people who got the feedback version, sometimes people will post an assignment and they'll do like a little write-up because like something really clicked for them when doing the assignment. And sometimes what clicked for them is like some of the really far out stuff that the course was, that I was trying to do with the course. And that's like, that's basically beyond being hardening. That's like life affirming on this side of things in this little sphere of conscious existence that really crosses into life affirming. It's pretty nuts. I think that's about as light as I can make this without it competing with that, which I prefer that being very light. Yeah, FKTNM says, yeah, I made it. Welcome. Hi, Steven. Have you been playing with any more tree designs? Since that last stream? No, I've been working on other stuff for this project and things like that. Maybe, did I do another? No, I don't think I have, but I'll be back to that soon. What have I been doing since then? I've been doing a bunch of stuff for this project. I was doing some... back on my nonsense, trying to do some Last Judgment sketches. Stuff like this. This is recorded. These sketches will probably pop up in a YouTube video soon. What was that? 4? 3? I have some old streams where I've done other versions of these things, but a really big subject like this, I don't know, it's very difficult to get to a sketch that feels satisfactory just because there's so much going on. And yeah, I've done a lot of sketching for my project with Joe. Done a bunch of writing for YouTube videos, things like that. So yeah, no trees. But we will get back to trees. There is a YouTube video in the can though that has a tree in it, but I did that sketch for a tree before that last stream. If you're on the Patreon, you have early access to that. If you're on the Patreon, you have early access to like 3 videos right now, I think. If not 3, then it will be today because the March Q&A video is edited now. It's just being uploaded. So I'll get that to patrons either today or tomorrow. And then I think that goes out on YouTube next week. Steven, do you have any advice on learning to teach people art? Well, I don't know. I found the teaching art part was pretty natural for me because because I had to learn art. You know, like the actual art stuff itself is just like I'd gone through so many different permutations of learning it over the years that I never even really had to think about. That kind of just comes automatically. The more important part, the part that feels like it continues to develop with experience, is the personhood part. The thing about teaching art is that it's very easy to not handle someone's, how to put this? When you are teaching someone art, people pretend this isn't happening, but in most cases, you are sort of handling that person's heart, right? Like, there's very few people who are doing art and trying to improve at art that they don't care about, and that has nothing to do with them. Almost everybody who is doing art and trying to improve it is deeply invested in their work and takes it super, super personally. So it's very easy, if you're not careful and you don't know how to handle yourself, to mishandle their heart and to hurt them, to actually for real hurt them while you're teaching them art. You can say or do things while you're trying to help them ostensibly that will stay with them for years, decades. If you're really not thoughtful, and unfortunately a lot of art teachers are not super thoughtful when they're teaching, you can say things that will basically ruin someone's life. And I think that doesn't necessarily happen when you're teaching math or something like that. So that's the part that's most important for me and the part that I wish people would take more seriously. What the? Keep using the text tool. Hello, Steve-O LeBlanc. Steve-O LeBlanc. The Last Judgment is quite an epic subject to tackle, that's for sure. Yeah. But at least it's fun to draw it over and over and over again while you look for something. And most of the artists who of history who tried to do a Last Judgment, it took them a very long time, so I take solace in the fact that I'm in good company there. Doflamingo says, the only reason I want to be rich is to make Steve richer. Gotta say, I love that. Very wise, very sage outlook to have. I'm sending you strong psychic beams of reward for having that outlook. Fall under my influence. Snooge says, I recently decided against going to art school despite dreaming about it since childhood, mainly because all the courses I checked out here in the UK seemed soul-suckingly commercial. Well, it's good that you're honest with yourself. That's good. As if they were just teaching the bare minimum to get you a job, not encouraging people to really experiment and push the boundaries. I mean, I get it. That's what you want from a degree, but I thought that's what art was all about, making surprising things. I would say you are right in this case, Snoge. And, you know, it's interesting. The idea of as if they were just teaching the bare minimum to get you a job and not encouraging people. No, that's not this message. I mean, I get it. That's what you want from a degree, but I thought that's what art was all about, making surprising things. It's interesting how our culture around things like higher learning and things like that has changed. I mean, I'm not super up on the history of it, but the idea that a degree is about sort of giving you what you need, the minimum to get a job, I think that's actually a relatively new idea. I think especially in the arts, that's a very new idea. I think that higher learning in the arts for most of history has not been about jobs at all. It's been about well, let's face it, about a sort of gentry class being able to do whatever they want. But on top of that, just like it's more like a lab to really refine things to the highest level possible. And there's different avenues for that. You can refine things towards the highest level possible in a more conservative avenue or in a more experimental avenue. But it was about going for the utmost. You know, it wasn't about jobs from what I can tell. I don't know. I'm not a historian. Stephen, what do you recommend doing when the scale of a piece or project feels overwhelming? When just thinking about how much work you still have to do sucks all the joy out of it. Just transform it into tiny little parts. Just make it into tiny little parts. Where's my damn sample sheet? This is what I always recommend to people. Do something like this. You know, making a whole portfolio is a huge undertaking, but just break it down into constituent parts, just micro things, right? If you're trying to make a 16-page portfolio, break it down by page, break it down by the step for every single page, and just instead of being paralyzed by the overwhelming abstract bigness of the undertaking, you just wake up each day and say, all right, today we'll try to have an idea for page one. And you just try to make the cell green. Next day, all right, I'm going to sketchbook page one. Make it green. All right, I'm going to gather reference for page one. Make it green. All right, it's time to do the real sketch for what page one is going to be. All right, well, you didn't do it in a day, you make it orange. You keep coming back. Still orange, still orange, still orange. It takes 5 days, now it's green. And you just pull back several layers and all you care about is turning cells green, you know? Is this a personal piece? Yes. I'm doing it for a project with my buddy, Joe. Damn, my throat is having a lot of trouble right now. This is usually the time of day when my allergies peak. Sorry, give me a second. Tony Robinson, is there gay men that draw in this community? Undoubtedly. Is that what you got your messages deleted for before by Ahmed? I see. All right, Tony, if you're being sincere, that's fine. If you're not being sincere, you're an asshole, but you're being just a little pushy. You're posting about it a lot. So, I mean, it doesn't look like you're getting many takers. So I would just drop it, all right? And if you don't, I'll ban you the next time you mention it. I am sincere, that's fine. Still don't mention it again. I am you're not at all entitled to use my platform to advertise for any community of any sort. And you're just being a little pushy. So it doesn't matter that you're sincere. I'm saying you're not an asshole because you were being sincere. Perfectly fine thing to look for, but don't post about it anymore. You're posting about it too much. Steven BB Boy, what are you allergic to so I know what to avoid on our date? I don't know. I actually don't know. I think it's, I've never gotten tested. I think it's tree pollen, because I feel like when I go to like the beach and stuff like that, where there's no trees, I instantly feel better. Making this wall that was here look more like it's made out of thorns, as was the original intent. All right. I'm sorry, Tony. I know you've been a fan for a long time. You can continue to be a fan in silence. You could still watch all the videos, but you have to understand, on the internet, just to be this pushy about something like this, it's just better not take a risk. It's just kind of coming off like you're being an asshole. So I'm just gonna ban you. Krita is cool. Yes, it is. I tried it once, and it is cool. It just hasn't stuck with me. You know what's really cool about Krita is that it's free. Now that's cool. Now that's really cool. Free goes a long way. Hey, Steven, fourth attempt. Do you have any tips for form in digital? A lot of people shy away from using the airbrush. Use the airbrush. It's okay. In any medium, form is about the modeling factors. You know, that is the only thing that ever makes something feel formy, three-dimensional, like it is affected by light. And the modeling factors obviously float free of any particular medium, right? You can depict form light, form shadow, center light, halftone, specular reflection, ambient occlusion, cast shadow, reflected light. You can depict all of those in any medium. So you just focus on those. But yeah, as far as digital goes, I don't know. Yeah, I really like using the airbrush. It gets a bad rep. And then a lot of people wonder, like, why can't I turn a soft turn on this form? You're not using a soft brush? But I thought I wasn't allowed to use soft brushes. Are they blocked on your Photoshop? Did a teacher install an add-on that makes it so that you can't use them? I use the airbrush constantly. I'll do half a painting with the airbrush. You just need to know how to balance it, you know? And if you're focusing on trying to create the modeling factors, that will sort of automatically balance you out, because it'll just The modeling factors sort of automatically ask for specific shapes. And because you're trying to make specific shapes, you'll automatically make hard edges, soft edges, medium edges. And so even if you're just using the airbrush, if your mind is in the right place thinking about the modeling factors, it will help you balance out. Paint over this foreground guy for a little bit. Damn it, I keep using the text tool. Steven, have you ever tried fasting as a way of meditation and such? Only once in high school. Had a class I loved called, I think it was for, what was it? It was either, many faiths or... Damn, I forgot what the other one was. But it was these two classes taught by the same teacher that were about world religions and spirituality. Two of my favorite classes I ever took, not just in high school, but ever. And in one of them, he, you know, it was an assignment. You had to do it unless your parents signed you out of it. He had us do a 24-hour fast. So not really a long one, but that was the only time I've ever done it. And it was interesting. Good way to keep you mindful, you know. Make the silhouettes of these thorns that are crossing in front of this light area. I'm going to make them more dramatic because they kind of have a nice effect cutting in front of that area, but they're sort of scared, shoved down. I'm going to look for a way to make it more like that or something like that. Take advantage of that high contrast passage. Drawing is fun. Drawing is fun. Why does YouTube continue to not notify me, says Daryl Grant. I don't know. YouTube's mean like that. Hello, Reynola Dominguez. I'm having a lot of trouble with my throat right now. Sorry, guys. I might have to cut this off soon. How many times in a week do you meditate, or maybe every day? I'm a daily guy, but I also acknowledge that, you know, it goes in seasons, you know. There's definitely been times where I've fallen off for, you know, I don't know, maybe, you know, month, you know, something like that. But in general, try to keep it pretty regular. These days I'm a daily type of a guy. Now I don't think that's something you, not like something you have to do or should do. I mean, I do it daily because it feels nice, you know? The Buddha would be very disappointed. The Zen masters would be great, very disappointed. Ah, meditating because it feels good. Not good. I want it to keep high. No, but then it kind of looks weird that it recedes back to this door so quickly. Yay or nay? Yay or nay? Policing shapes is... that's what I'm doing right now, is policing shapes, and it's really part of a painting that can take basically infinite amount of time. Tea and honey, yeah. If I wasn't on stream right now, I would have made tea already, but I don't want to break up stream like that. Are the giant mushrooms or Lilliput world? They are big mushrooms. There's some figures for scale. Little slugins of the figures for scale. Pretty big. Andrew Gray says, oh wait, I missed another question. Autumn Rose says, another random question, but like, how do you go about drawing fat on the body and making it look believable? I would definitely spend a lot of time with reference, the body types, especially, you know, average, skinnier, heavier. They're actually so fascinatingly different, and I think it's, if you haven't, worth it to spend a lot of time drawing reference, looking at reference. I spent a lot of my life going to life drawing. You get heavy models all the time. So a lot of close observation of how things hang and get affected by gravity and compress and things like that. But yeah, as a general principle, like I just alluded to, the main things for me are the effect of gravity gets exaggerated. So things hang more, droop more, and things compress more. So where the body is pressing against a chair or the ground, there will be more mass being thrust up, some iconic like compression wrinkles and ripples around that part of the body where it's meeting the surface. And also areas where the body touches itself. So like where the arm leans into the armpit, you get more exaggerated, massy folds of flesh where leg meets leg on the inside of the thigh. If you push those two things, that always feels like a more realistic depiction of fat for me. Also note the way being heavier affects the negative shapes of the body. The negative shape being the background, or that is to say, the way the foreground, the figure, cuts against the field. So thin bodies tend to make these iconic negative shapes that are different from the ones that a heavy body makes, and a heavy body will resist making certain shapes. So, for example, it's like I have a pretty middling build, right? So, see this negative shape between my arm and my torso here? This negative shape is very easy for an average or skinny body type to make in many, many views. This negative shape will be much smaller or not show up as often on the very heavy body type. There's just much more mass that overlaps and meets and closes. So that negative shape will close to that small in a lot of poses, or just won't be present in more poses where it would be if they had the average or thin body type. I think that is something people miss a lot about drawing the different body types. And all of those things, it varies from body type to body type. It's not just heavy to the others. It's, you know, the average body type has different negative shapes than the thin body type. The thin body type has different negative shapes than the average and the heavy. Okay. Part of me thinks I should keep drawing now, more than ever now, but another part wants me to rest because my birthday is getting close. Hey, you got to celebrate your birthday. You've got to enjoy your birthday. I'm going to call this here for now because my throat is really bugging me, and I got something in about 20 minutes that I have to go to. So let's start wrapping it here, and I always like to end when I know what I would do next. So I'm going to leave a little note to myself that finishing up this thorn fence and that bridge is what I would do next. Yeah, I did a few important things that needed to be done on this picture. I always work a little slow on stream, but especially figuring out the value changes on that leading in path. That was good. That was necessary work that needed to be done. Speed by here, some meditation talk. Hey, Steven, do you have any tips to actually start making money with art? I feel very good with the state of my drawings, but don't really know where to start making it a job. It's digital art, by the way. It depends what kind of art you make. I don't really know. If you want to be a fine artist, try to get into shows, send some of your stuff to... There's galleries that show digital work or do prints and stuff like that. It's a little trickier to get into. I don't know, I'm not a fine artist, so it's hard for me to say, but just from me looking at it from the outside, start asking around, going to those openings, getting in. If you're more looking for like a job, which is what I assume because you use the word job, you want to work at a company or something like that or work for clients, put together curated portfolios. So pick an industry, a niche, or a particular company you would like to work for, and don't just have the general portfolio. Make a PDF that's just for them, basically, and start building that. When you focus like that and you start making the PDF, do you find you actually have enough work where you feel like you're hireable, or do you feel like you're a little light? If you're light, make work that you feel fills the gap, and if you feel good about it, start sending it. get in touch with people over there. You can find these people on LinkedIn, Twitter, stuff like that. Not for every company, but for a lot of them. And start sending work. Don't be annoying, right? You have to have some emotional intelligence. You can't be poking people all the time. But, you know, if we're talking like art directors and things like that, the people who hire for art positions, most are not annoyed by getting an introductory email to show work once. You know, they're interested in seeing, you know. If the work's not good enough, don't expect a response, right? They don't have a lot of time to respond, but they're not going to get offended. They'll just be like, all right, well, they're not ready. And they'll leave the email. They're going to get annoyed if you keep sending over and over again. You know, if you send your portfolio, you know, 5 times a year with no response. But it's okay to start shopping some work around. You never know what's going to come from it. A lot of companies have submission emails on their websites, you know. Do you stream on Twitch as well or just on YouTube? Just on YouTube. Do you use a mirror sometimes while you draw? Yeah. Or I'll use my cell phone as a mirror. I'll do this. I'll keep my phone off and I will put my phone against the inside of my nose. And with this eye, I will look into the cell phone and that gives you a pretty undistorted mirror reflection of what you're drawing. So I don't need to do it digital because I can just actually flip the canvas. But when I'm doing a pencil drawing, yeah, I'll do this sometimes. Use that to see what's off balance, things like that. That way you don't need a big mirror. You just take a small mirror and hold it like that. Tuma says, thank you for making me draw instead of doom scrolling. That's why I'm here, baby. That is why I'm here. Damn. I gotta fix this. I gotta fix my allergies. I'm trying to get through a bottle of old allergy medication that usually works, but it's not doing great. I think it's expired by like a week. So I'm hoping. I normally don't care about that, but I'm desperate now, so I'm hoping I'm just about done. I'm going to go get some new allergy medication in the next couple of days, and hopefully some fresh ones will actually work, because this stuff usually works, but it's not working. All right, everybody. Thank you, Drawing Dama. Costelinha, thank you. Take care, Steve LeBlanc. Goodbye, Angel. Goodbye, Fier. Goodbye, Arctic Monkey. Goodbye, Charlie Wings. Goodbye, Sploige. Goodbye, Reynola Dominguez. Go get your tea. Oh, yeah. Got a few minutes here to make some tea real quick. Autumn Rose says, I love drawing with you guys today. We're very happy to have you, Autumn Rose. Thank you, everybody who was drawn today. Thanks for keeping me company while I poked at this guy. I'll probably poke at him more off stream, so hopefully next time you see him, he'll be even more developed. Unless I go back and do... Uh-oh, where'd my other sketch go? Did I delete it? Shit. I think I might have deleted the other sketch. That's all right, though, because I actually have a duplicate of this file, so that's convenient. All right. Goodbye, everybody. Take care. Happy drawing, everyone. Bye-bye.